hopes for Indian Land becoming a town of its own are now entirely on the people who live here. I'm CN2's Zane Cena, and Lancaster County has voted down incorporating the Panhandle, saying that's a decision for residents to make.
Plus, later in CN2 Sports, we go deep into Lancaster County for a battle between the Jackets and the Volunteers. CN2's Jeremy Winder has highlights, plus a major honor for two former coaches. Your news starts right now. Happy Wednesday to you, and thank you so much for joining us here at CN2 News. I'm Lucas McFadden. First up tonight, Representative Brandon Guffey goes to Washington. On this Wednesday, members of Congress are holding a committee hearing about the online child sexual exploitation crisis. South Carolina State House Representative Brandon Guffey was invited to attend the hearing in Washington. This after he filed a lawsuit against Meta, the parent company of Facebook and Instagram, claiming the social media platforms have intentionally designed addictive algorithms that target children. Guffey lost his son to suicide after his son, Gavin, was a victim of sextortion. During the hearing today, members of Congress were given the opportunity to question with representatives from social media channels such as X, TikTok, Snapchat, Discord, again, Facebook, and Instagram. Many of the questions addressed the safety concerns surrounding the social media giants and how they were planning on ensuring the safety of children on their platforms. Representative Guffey did not testify today. However, South Carolina Senator Lindsey Graham shared Gavin Guffey's story and gave his comments on what those social media platforms have done.
Mr. Zuckerberg, you and the companies before us, I know you don't mean it to be so, but you have blood on your hands. You have a product. You have a product that's killing people.
While nothing was determined today, Representative Brandon Guffey says this is the first step that will hopefully bring change to the tech world by implementing better tools that will better protect children from the dangers of the internet. Talks to make Indian Land its own city back on the table, but the Lancaster County Council was quick to say, no thank you. At least it's not something they're going to push for at the given time. That decision being made during a public meeting Tuesday night where county officials announced they will not be taking steps to incorporate Indian Land at this time or any other time. Leaders say incorporating the Panhandle area and making it another town in Lancaster would not make sense for Lancaster County leaders to decide, as Indian Land voters already voted against the decision back in 2018. Our camera's catching up with the Lancaster County Administrator on this Wednesday during that annual County Council retreat, where he confirmed the county is now taking a more neutral role on Indian Land's incorporation, leaving that decision, again, entirely up to the residents.
But even talking about governance, how do people want to organize their services? We think with the county, we've been providing top-notch services. We understand that growth is a push point or a pinch point, as we say. So we understand that people may be a little frustrated with how services have been delivered. And so people can make their own self-governance determination, but it's not a role that county government's going to be involved in. We're happy to educate. But again, it will not be a recommendation for incorporation going forward.
Our reporter getting reactions from several people who live in Lancaster's Panhandle. Many say they feel they need more information on the benefits of incorporating before making their decision. One resident also feels incorporating could lead to a tax increase. County leaders continue to plan, though, for the future, spending the council retreat discussing budget concerns and infrastructure updates to improve all of Lancaster County. Here's our latest picture of the day. Today marks the 63rd anniversary of the Friendship 9 sit-in in Rock Hill. It was back on January the 31st, 1961. Nine students, including Thomas Gaither, walked nearly a mile from Friendship College to McCrory's Five and Dime, now known as Counter on Main Street. Nine of those 10 men declined to pay the $100 in bail money and were jailed for 30 days, starting the Jail No Bail movement. Pictured right there, well, they are W.T. Dub Massey and David Williamson Jr. of the Friendship Nine, seated at that famous counter back in 2021. Welcome back to CN2 News. Stephon Sanders of York County is a young entrepreneur who recently earned a presidential award. Our news partner, Channel 9's Tina Terry, with more on how he's defying the odds and inspiring others with his company. It's all in tonight's CN2 Business Spotlight.
Stephon Sanders boldly walking into his future.
I'm excited, but I'm kind of nervous at the same time. Not sure if I'm really ready.
The humble and soft-spoken senior at York Comprehensive High School is a college-bound athlete with good grades and 30 college credits already under his belt. And in his spare time, he manages Street Games LLC, a company he created with help from his mom.
We have 3 TVs outside, actually. It's raining, but we have 3 TVs outside where you can play the Nintendo Switch. We have the TVs inside, all the new consoles, PS5, Xbox. We have all VR. We even have a DJ booth. Madden, NBA 2K.
Stephon and his mom renovated this school bus, making it the ultimate game room for mobile parties. He came up with the idea while looking for something fun to do on his birthday.
I wanted to do something like that for my 13th birthday party, and I couldn't find anything that would give like a flexible experience.
I got into the military and I put everything I had behind him after he showed me that he was committed to it.
Stephon also volunteers, speaking to other young people about entrepreneurship.
Please give a warm and round of applause for Stephon Sanders.
That led to this President's Volunteer Award that he took home this weekend. He wants other teens to know they can accomplish the things they set their minds to.
Chase their dreams and don't let other people like opinions affect on how they want to chase their dreams and aspirations.
CN2's Business Spotlight is brought to you by the law offices of Wilkerson, Jones, and Wilkerson. Big enough to fight, small enough to care.
Stephon Sanders is a finalist for the South Carolina Young Entrepreneur of the Year Award. Here's your CN2 7-day forecast. Mostly sunny Thursday with highs in the upper 50s. Friday, we will see partly sunny skies with highs in the mid-60s. The weekend will stay dry both days with mostly sunny skies. Highs Saturday reaching 60 degrees. Sunday, we'll see more clouds and cooler temperatures with highs in the lower 50s. There may be some showers Sunday night, but the better chance for rain comes Monday. Also is a better chance for cooler weather with highs near 50 degrees. And tonight's CN2 digital dashboard, students in the Rock Hill School District celebrating 100 days of learning. Some elementary schools held 100 days smarter parties. At other schools, students dressed up for the occasion wearing t-shirts and hats commemorating the number of the day, and some students even dressed up as senior citizens. The teachers combined the 100 days of school with assignments such as counting to 100 with fun items like marbles.
Welcome back. I love sitting in this chair talking with interesting people, and you're not going to find someone much more interesting than Pat Grant. She has such a history here in our community. She is now hosting the Betty Jo Ray program called City Minute that we've so happily handed over to you. There's nobody that could fill the spot better. She would love to know that her friend is in that seat, still keeping history alive, because it was so important to both of you that these stories are not forgotten.
That's right, and history preservation was important to us, and she knew everything about Rock Hill. You know? So we were so fortunate to have Betty Jo, a true blessing for Rock Hill.
She is missed. There is a lovely book that she wrote sitting here in her honor, and what turned into briefly a truly minute program, which over the years it has been, is now back to 30 minutes. Pat, so graciously helping to organize these programs. Talk about what you would like for the program to be and what people can look forward to.
Well, I would like to, for the City Minute, to have a great variety of things that are going on in Rock Hill. Things that the upcoming birthday that we're going to have in the nation, the 250th birthday. This is the perfect venue to get out the early notice of that, which we will. And so we've tried to talk about the different segments, and we have good programs lined up through April. And it's just getting out not only the history of Rock Hill, but the things that Rock Hill is involved in, what people can look forward to.
Every 2 weeks on CN2 Extra is where you can find the program. Right. And it really is the places, the city, but all of that comes down to people. At our core, what makes us great are the people. Mm-hmm. So talk about those different people over the years, not anyone necessarily in particular, but what a show like this is able to highlight, and maybe how those folks are inspirational to younger folks coming up, that people can make a difference and people can have an impact.
Well, there are many people in my life that we work together, and in the history area, Chip Hutchison, Gary Williams, and I are a good team that we work for history preservation, both for the historic Rock Hill and the city of Rock Hill, and that we promote and work through the lifelong learning program, and we do history for them as well. But when you look at the history, and we were just talking about what Betty Jo Ray set up for Rock Hill, the broad, the big umbrella that we live under that she created with the empowering the vision. We had Doug Eccles and Mayor Geddes, and they're still seeing the vision of Rock Hill as not just the economy, a great economy that we have now through sports tourism, but through the arts program, through the environment, through the different things that volunteers are stepping forward and working in Rock Hill. And I think a lot of that started with Betty Jo Ray.
I think volunteerism here is exceptional. I only have so much comparison in my life. I've lived in a number of cities, but when we moved here, I was and am still blown away by the true time commitment that people give. This isn't just a one and done. This is years.
Yeah. We were just talking with Debbie Abels, who actually lives in Charlotte, but she has volunteered in Rock Hill. Her job here as publisher of the Herald was in Rock Hill, and she did so many big things. And you look at people who volunteer. We've had Alice Davis here, and her brother David, Alice Williams Davis, her brother David, and the father Gary, they all, you think that they give back so much to the community that where do they have time for a real job? Mm-hmm. But just like Betty Jo, you know, she was mother and wife and church, and yet she still turned the mayor job from a part-time job to a full weekday job.
Yeah, you know, full time and then some. Yeah. And what's also really neat about family you mentioned and others I think of, and again, for any newcomers to the area, we're talking about the history, but you can still be part of it. It's multi-generational volunteerism. It's the grandparents and the kids and the young grandkids are now getting involved. And that's the beauty when you go to the Come See Me's and Christmasvilles, you really do see, you know, the old adage, it takes a village.
Yeah. Even though we're a young city from 1852, we have generational businesses here where we've had the first one, I think of several that we have, where we're into the fourth and fifth generation of families who have been in Rock Hill. And those founding fathers are still, they have descendants who are still giving back to Rock Hill in different ways. We are no longer in that survival mode where nothing but the economy matters. Right. You know, we're up in a higher level now of where people are able to give back. And in the beginning, we had so few citizens in Rock Hill. We're talking about a few hundred who got the city started. And so they worked in multiple areas. And we still have that going on with volunteers. They're still on various boards and giving back from one thing to the other. So volunteerism in Rock Hill has been high.
Absolutely. And you're certainly one of the people I would put at the top of that list. Thank you for spending some time with us and for all that you're continuing to do.
Well, thank you for asking, and thank you for producing the City Minute for the citizens of Rock Hill.
Please tune in, because if you want to learn more, you're going to have a wealth of information when you tune in. Thanks for watching. We'll have much more after this.
Carolina Connection is brought to you by Wild Birds Unlimited. For more information, visit rockhill.wbu.com or indianland.wbu.com. Wild Birds Unlimited. We bring people and nature together.
I certainly hope you dance as well as you dress.
There's only one way to find out.
You and I, we're not so different. Agent Argyle.
It'll help.
Hold on.
The book is phenomenal, sweetie, but...
What happens next?
It's called a cliffhanger, Mother.
Ellie, it's called a cop-out.
Whoa! Hey! There's a cat in there!
Oh, my God. You're Ellie freaking Conway.
Author of Argyle series, Ellie Conway! I am such a fan!
Oh, yeah? What is it you do?
Espionage.
Would you...
sign my book.
Here we go.
I love this book. Come on.
People.
Real life spies.
Why would they care about me?
Because you're a fortune teller, Ellie. Why can't you see? What you wrote in your new book actually happened, and you kicked a hornet's nest you didn't even know existed.
I'm in some really big trouble, Mom. What you doing
for me? Oh, so now you're experimenting with drugs.
I want all assets on them now.
I need her to write the next chapter.
God, I hate that cat.
It's time for you to meet the real Agent Argyle.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
Oh
my God.
CN2 at the Movies is brought to you by American Air Heating and Cooling.
This is CN2 Sports. It was a night full of recognitions and blowouts at Andrew Jackson High School. CN2's Jeremy Wander there capturing all the highlights, and he has reaction in your Wednesday sports report.
It was a big night at Andrew Jackson High School. Not only were they taking on cross county foe Buford High, but it was also a night of reunions as well as court dedication for two former coaches at the school, the late Barbara Tyler and John Boyd. Both coached multiple sports and brought state titles to the school, whose gymnasium floor will be known as Tyler Bird Court going forward. Between games, Coach Bird and the family of Coach Tyler were presented with commemorative plaques. And more presentations from Andrew Jackson in your midweek CN2 Sports Digital Scoreboard. Prior to the girls' game, junior post player Tamia Watkins was recognized for scoring her 2,000th career point against Chesterfield back on January 23rd. Watkins is back at AJ after spending the previous year at Legion Collegiate Academy, making her accomplishment all the more remarkable. As for the game, Tamia was simply dominant against the Yellow Jackets, but she was not alone, as her teammate Nyana Asbell also scored in double figures in the first half of the game. The lopsided score allowed Coach Stephen Fair the opportunity to rest his starters in the second half, as the Lady Yellow Jackets made a run in the third quarter, scoring the first 15 points of the second half. But this was just too little too late, as Andrew Jackson gets another big win, moving to 8-0 in region play with four games to go. Afterwards, I caught up with the star of the night.
It was really good. I'm very proud of myself. You know, I went through a lot, and I'm just glad I got to accomplish some things that other people are not going to be able to accomplish.
As for the boys' game, it featured a lot of action from much of the the night, with one key difference. While Buford did most of their damage on the interior, as Adam Morris and Gage McManus combined to score 29 points, they still could not equal the scoring output of Bryce Peterson, who was on fire from beyond the arc as he knocked down three after three after three, scoring 34 points on the night. Also getting in on the fun was sophomore Zeke Clyburn with 22 and former CN2 Athlete of the Week on the football field, Trey Thompson. He had 10 points as the Andrew Jackson boys double up Buford 96-42. And from high school to college, congratulations to the Clinton College Lady Golden Bears, who got their third win of the season and first at home Tuesday night, knocking off Voorhees 64-59. It was still quite the challenge as the Golden Bears entered the fourth, trailing by six, and had to make a comeback to get the win. They were led by Jasmine Jenkins and Ja'Kia Willis, who each had 21 points, as Kaylin Davis chipped in 18 of her own, as only six players took the court for Clinton. Next up, a trip to Morris College on Friday night. Finally, it's time to hit the mat as Saturday, the first round of the state wrestling playoffs will begin, and here's a look at the matchups for our area schools. The reigning defending state champion Fort Mill Yellow Jackets will actually have a bye, but their rival, the Nation 4 Falcons, will be hitting the road to take on Hillcrest. The Clover Blue Eagles will be taking on the Dorman Cavaliers. Kane Beard and his Rock Hill Bearcats will be in Anderson at T.O. Hanna. The Catawba Ridge Copperheads will visit Lawrence, while the Indian Land Warriors will welcome in Wade Hampton. And also at home, the Chester Cyclones will take on the Fountain Inn Fury. See you Thursday for our latest CN2 Athlete of the Week segment. Until then, hope you have a good evening. This is Jeremy Winder, CN2 Sports.
All right, Jay, thank you very much. And thank you very much for joining us. We'll see you back here tomorrow. Good night.